Everyone, we all have a drink, are you comfortable? Okay, great. So thank you very, very much for attending our third meetup. Definitely the biggest attendance so far. Hands up, who was at the first and second meetups? Okay, pretty good. So, and hands up, who's new?
Oh.
Brilliant. Welcome. So, luckily, I won't be speaking too much tonight, so it's all about our guests. And over the 12 months, obviously, we've set ourselves a really high goal to try and escape the rat race within 12 months. And I know that everyone here is very like-minded individuals and looking forward to sharing techniques and strategies with one another throughout the 12 months that can all help us get there a lot faster. And we've had some great success stories already over the last month within our secret Facebook group. So if you're not already a member of that Facebook group, please message me and connect with me through Meetup and I'll invite you in, because there's some really good interesting conversation and strategies and information that's happening every day there. So anyway, I'm not going to waste too much time. Tonight is more about our two very special guests. So later on, after the break, you'll be hearing from Kevin Whelan. And I've already told you all about Kevin and the wonderful connection that I made with Kevin nearly a year ago. And we've been working to build up Wealth Builders Company. And also, Kevin's been sharing and kind of really helping me to understand how to achieve financial freedom and the steps to take and the foundations that are crucial. Because none of us just want to quit our job and then be left with no money and all sorts of problems. So Kevin's going to be sharing a special presentation later with all of you. So that's something to look forward to. But first off, we have Gerry Robert. So I first met Gerry long time ago. Must have been, January this year. So I attended Gerry's wonderful weekend boot camp, which was Publish a Book and Grow Rich. And I learned so much that weekend, and I blew my mind. And I asked Gerry at the end of the event, I said, "Gerry, could I grab 5 minutes with you and just interview you and gain some of your wisdom?" And Gerry very kindly obliged, and I put that interview up, and I think a few of you have heard that and have told me how much you enjoyed listening to that. So it just so happened Gerry was going to be in town tonight, and I just couldn't resist the opportunity to get him down here to speak to you guys. And most of you already know, but Gerry is the author of Millionaire Mindset, and you'll all be receiving a copy of that, downloadable copy at the end of the evening, and also Gerry's forthcoming book, which is Multiply Your Business. So you'll probably be hearing a few little nuggets of wisdom from both of those books tonight, but let's hand it over to the man himself. So hand you over, please, a very warm welcome to my friend Gerry Robert. All right.
Positive guy, isn't he? Let's give him a hand for putting this whole thing together. Man, I'm so impressed. He asked me when he found out I was coming, or I'll be in London today, he said, "Do you believe in free speech?" Will you come and speak for free? Yes, I would be happy. It's good to be here. You know, I love speaking with entrepreneurs. I've been doing this now for close to 30 years. Spoken to about 3 million people. And it's always good to be with people who want to get out of the rat race. They're a different crowd. You guys are slightly insane, and I am very happy to be with you guys because, you know, you're looking to do better, do more, have more, be more, and I wouldn't think of a better place for me to be tonight. And you know how speakers always say that they're glad to be where they are giving a speech? Sometimes it's not true. I remember one time I was giving a speech at a large psychiatric unit, nutcases. And I figured this out fairly quickly. It was a big crowd. And I had just started speaking, and one of the patients at the back of the room stood up, and he yelled, "This is a lousy speech!" I was a new speaker. I didn't know what to do. And so nobody turned around. Nobody said anything. The guy sat down. I was thankful for that, I'll tell you. And so I figured they paid me to give a speech that I should probably keep going, you know. And so I put myself together and I kept going in my talk. About 10 minutes later, the guy stands up again. And he is furious. I don't know what I've said to the guy, but he's ticked at something. And so I'm listening to him, and he's yelling now at the top of his lungs. This is junk. Nothing you say makes sense. You're the worst speaker in the whole world. And I can't believe what's happening. And he's coming toward me, right in the middle of my speech. And you know, when a nut job, when a audience member is coming toward you in the middle of your speech, you got to do something, right? So I turned to the psychiatrist who was sitting right in the front row. I said, "Doc, what do you want me to do? You know, should I keep going?" Psychiatrist says, "Yes, keep going." He says, "This is great therapy." I don't need any more therapy, Doc. He said this. He said, "That's the first sensible thing that patient has said in 2 years." That I was a lousy speaker. So I wasn't glad to be there, but I'm glad to be here tonight. Nothing like that's going to happen tonight, right? I want to make sure. All right, well, let's get into it. By the way, I'm from Canada. I'm not from America. I'm Canadian. We're nice. But I like to start the seminars by having what I call a transparency statement. How many of you think I'm going to try and sell you something tonight? Let me see your hands. Yeah, I promise not to disappoint you. Here's what I do. Here's the way I approach it. I ask people to make a deal. You all see there's an order form about my seminar. It's really expensive, and so it's not for everybody. But what I ask people to make a deal is this. I hate going to seminars where the guy's trying to sell you the whole time. I'm not going to do that. What I do instead is I ask people, if I give you some good ideas to help you escape the rat race, I'm going to tell you my story and how I did. If I give you some good ideas that you could use, could we make a deal that I take a few minutes at the end of the talk to talk about my seminar? Is that a good deal?
Yeah.
Let me see your hands if you think that's a good deal. Okay. So that's what I'm going to do. Rather than going to a seminar where the guy's trying to sell you the whole time, that just drives me crazy. So, and maybe it's because I'm Canadian, I don't know, but so we'll put the order form away for now. And I am doing a seminar this weekend in Toronto, and again in April. I come here probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 times a year from Toronto. And when you travel a lot, not so much anymore, but I have 3 boys, and when the kids were small, it was tough for Anne to take care of these 3 kids. I'm married to my teenage sweetheart. We've been married for 31 years. And so when I was traveling a lot when they were small, it's tough taking care of 3 boys. Does anybody here have 3 boys? You're all looking pretty young. No. Anybody have kids? Okay, I want to make sure. Now you're looking at me a little strange. How many of you won't put your hands up no matter what I'm going to ask tonight? So I had 3 boys, and when I would travel, Anne would take care of these kids. And, you know, normally I would come back from a trip, and maybe I've gone 2-3 weeks or 2 weeks sometimes. And when I get to the airport, she basically hand me these kids and say, "They're yours now, you take care of them." Except one time I had been in Australia, and I'd been gone for 21 days, and I get to the airport, and Anne meets me at the airport with the 3 kids. And she was smiling from ear to ear. And I'm thinking, why are you so happy? I've been gone for a long time. So my young son picks up a hamster cage. And he said, "Dad, Mom started a hamster farm while you're away to deal with stress or something," she said. I thought, okay, well, if that floats your boat, that's okay with me. And then the other son says, "Dad," because I noticed there were 3 hamsters in this little cage. She said, my other son said, "Dad, there are 2 males and 1 female in the cage. 2 males and 1 female." But when you breed animals, isn't it the other way around? Normally, you have 2 females for every male. So I said to her, "You don't need 2 males." She says, "You do if one travels all the time." And I normally take her with me now on these trips. Let's go ahead and just a quick little thing about our seminar, because it's a good seminar, but I won't want you to take
it. As far as the workshop, I thought it was horrible, especially the part where he told me how to do everything so that I don't have to figure anything out. I thought that was really, you know, he took the struggle out of it for me, and I hate that. I hate knowing how to do everything now.
So what I want to do tonight is give you some practical strategies that you can use to help you get out of the rat race. My promise tonight is that I'm going to show you the fastest path to the biggest cash. I have been doing this for 30 years. You'll hear my story in a minute. I'm going to show you how to generate more leads than you know what to do with. How many of you are, because I don't really know, how many of you are self-employed? Okay, good. How many of you are in sales and marketing? How many of you work at a job right now? How many of you want to leave that job right now? Some of you didn't put your hand up. You may be here with somebody from work. So I'm going to show you some different ideas on how you can generate more leads for those of you who are in business, how to instantly differentiate yourself in the marketplace, how to dismantle prospect skepticism, which we'll talk about later, how to position yourself as an expert, how to brand yourself as an authority, make prospects chase you instead of you chasing them, how to close more sales faster and easier, and then give you what I think is the easiest and most predictable way to lead the rat race. Is that of interest to you? Okay. So we're going to talk about that. I'm going to go really quickly. I find that people can listen almost faster than I can talk, so ideas are going to start coming really quickly, and you may feel a little bit like this. The ideas are going to start flying.
There we go.
All right, so ideas are going to start flowing. So what I want to do tonight is talk to you about how a book is a phenomenal tool to generate more income and give you the springboard to escape the rat race. And I want you to keep an open mind, because what I'm going to talk to you about is very different than anything you've ever heard of before. I'm not talking about writing a book to make money selling books. There's very little money in that arena. But I find that if you do it the way I'm suggesting, and I'll give you lots of examples of people, ordinary people, because I deal primarily with entrepreneurs or people who want to become entrepreneurs, people who want to, you know, improve their life, their finances, their business. I'm going to give you lots of examples of ordinary people like you who have used the book the way I'm suggesting, even though most, how many of you here have ever thought about writing a book? Let me see your hands. Okay. For those of you who haven't, just keep an open mind, because I'm going to show you a different way of doing it so that you can use that book to facilitate. Why is the book such an effective tool? Well, it's an ad without looking like an ad. It's a way for you to build trust, for those of you who are in sales, before you even start selling. Can you imagine if you're a financial advisor and you were to send a book like this one does? Todd Dean sends this book before he has a sales call. He just literally sends this to the prospect before he goes. He writes in here, my mentor told me to give my book to the 100 most positive people in this city. I hear you're one of them. I can't wait to meet with you next week. What do you think this does in terms of opening the door for him and seeing how people will see him differently if they've seen that he's written a book? And I'm going to show you that you don't have to be an expert, you don't have to have a PhD, you don't have to have, you could be brand new in an industry using it the way I'm going to recommend. It helps you build trust, helps you become an instant expert. You know, we've done several research studies to find and interview people what they think of the various professions, and research after research is conclusive that people who view, when they're asked to list the professions that they trust the most, consistently, they trust authors more than almost any other profession. A book has a high perceived value, and so my recommendation, and you'll see more of it in a minute, but is that you don't try and sell books, give them away. Listen, if you're at a networking meeting, and maybe you've had this where you go to a networking meeting, maybe something like this, and somebody gives you 5 or 6 brochures, you know? And they say, if you know anybody who wants to buy insurance, would you give them one of these? What do you do with these little brochures as soon as they leave? They go in the bin. But if the person said, I've written this book about insurance and how people can understand the complexities of insurance,
Can I give you 5 or 6 of these? And if you know anybody, would you give it to them? Would you throw these out? Never. You probably gift wrap them and give them to people at Christmas time and pretend you bought them for them. Because it has a high perceived value. When you give a book, even a small little book like this, in the UK will have a 20, 25 pound perceived value, even though it's a much more economical way of doing it. So there's nothing that compares for this in terms of a brochure or a name card. If you use a book as a name card, you're going to be perceived much differently. Somebody said, you know, it's not who you know, but who knows you? I would add to that, it's how you're known to them. But if people see you differently, people will see you differently if they see your book like this. So a book is a phenomenal tool for those of you who are looking for leads. This lady was a consultant, a parenting consultant. She was taking out advertisements in the newspaper before. She's like, she heard this lecture. I only have one speech. It's this one. And I have a weekend boot camp. And so she listened to this lecture. She thought, I wonder if a book could help me in my business. I found out that she had a newspaper. She would take out a newspaper ad. She was spending $1,500 per week on the newspaper ad. And it was always profitable. So she would get, I think she would get 15 to 20 calls a week based on an ad. I had her change the ad. She wrote a small little book called Happy Kids. And I said to her, offer the book for free in a newspaper. Well, she went from 15 phone calls to up to 500 by offering a free book. Can you imagine what would happen if, you know, you could do one activity and get 500 people to call you, as opposed to what most people do today, which is to try and chase customers, try and find people. This guy that I mentioned earlier, I showed him one technique using the book. By offering the book for free, got 1,200 leads with one radio appearance. And he's just a salesman. And so what if you could get out of the fear or the things that would dismantle you or the things that would push you away from even thinking about this, I mean, you'd be shocked at what this could do to your business and to your income. You know, I'll show you lots of different people who are using the book. They're building a business around the book. For instance, how many of you here would like to be a speaker or do trainings and that sort of thing? Anybody here? Oh, great. Well, if you want to do speaking and training, by the way, there's a critical shortage of women speakers. Right. Just think about that. Think how many men, how many seminars you've been to, and they're all by middle-aged bald men. So, it's a phenomenal tool to build revenue and multiple sources of income around the book. A book gives you instant differentiation. So if you're in the business and you've got a lot of competition, you write a book instantly, you're different from everybody else who does what you do, even if you're brand new at an industry. You see, we tend to naturally gravitate to things that are unique. The problem is most people's advertising and marketing makes them look the same as everybody else. And so if you want a tool to instantly separate you, a book is the way to do it. It makes you an instant authority. It is never thrown out. So in terms of shelf life, people will throw away fancy brochures, CDs, DVDs, gizmos, and pens, and cups, and all these things that people try and use to build a business today. But they'll never throw away a book. It helps you get speaking engagement. As I mentioned, for those of you who want to become speakers, you cannot be really thought of seriously as a speaker without a book, especially in this day and age. It helps you close more sales. A book opens doors. If you have prospects that you're trying to get into and you have a hard time getting into them, send them a book. The door will open wide. Because how many free books do you think that person got last week from the author? It's a phenomenal tool to open doors. So give somebody a high five and say, you can do it.
You can do that. Wake up, you can do it. That's how
you do it. You may not think you can do it just yet. Let me give you my biases and then I'll tell you my story quickly. So my bias is that you publish the book yourself. So you write it, You hire an editor, you get somebody to design the cover, design the inside of the book, and print it here in London at a local printer. I say forget trying to find a traditional publisher. It's a waste of time for most of the way I recommend using a book. That's a waste of time. You know, for every book that they take on, they reject about 3,000 to 5,000. So the probabilities of this working in your case is very small. Instead, I say you take control of it and publish the book yourself. I say focus much more on the business around the book than on selling books. There's little money to be made selling books. But if you took a business, if you took a speaking engagement, if you took a seminar or what it is you want to build a business around and think that you could make thousands of pounds doing that, why would you ever want to make 10 pounds or 5 pounds selling a book? The big money is to build a business around the book or build a book around an existing business. Listen to what J. Conrad Levinson said. He wrote the guerrilla marketing books. He said, someone asked me how much money I made from my first book. The answer I gave was 10 million. The book itself only paid me 35,000 in royalties, but the speaking engagement, spin-off books, newsletters, columns, boot camps, consulting, and wide open doors resulted in the remaining 9,965,000. See, that's where the money is. And so people today, there's lots of, you may have heard people doing seminars on how to become an author and doing it the traditional way. That's not even remotely close to what I'm talking about. I'm talking about as a tool to open doors, generate more income, create multiple sources of income, and build a business if you do it the way I'm talking about it. And then it costs money to do this, and I show you how to get other people to pay for all the costs. And so, for example, how much do you think, this is a small little book, how much do you think it costs to print this book here in London? How much? It costs less than a pound to print this. And I know some people whose brochures, corporate brochures and packages, cost more than this. Yeah. And it'd never have anywhere near the effect that this would in terms of advancing your career and your business. So, if you were to spend, you know, a little bit of money, say 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, getting these things done, you'll end up with somewhere around, if the book is priced for at 20 pounds, 40,000 retail value of these books. And that has a high perceived value in the marketplace because of course you're gonna sell some, you'll just naturally sell some. I give away more books than I sell, but the ones I sell pay for the ones I give away. Right? So it costs money to do it, but I'm gonna show you later today how to get other people to pay for all of the costs associated with it. And show you how to do that before you write one word. You like that idea?
Yes.
Okay, now listen, I'm going to enthusiastically ask the questions, and you're going to enthusiastically answer the questions. Right?
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Otherwise, I have psychological tests that I give audiences. From Harvard Department of Psychiatry, Harvard University Department of Psychiatry. They develop a way for speakers to determine if an audience is a thinking audience or not. Do you want to take the test?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. You got to take the test. And if you don't answer my questions enthusiastically, I give you more and more tests. So you ready to take the test?
Yes.
Everybody go like this. Make a circle with your hands. Come on, everybody, make a circle like this. Okay, 1, 2, 3, put it on your chin. Go. Go. Where's your chin, Laura? Your chin! Chin is down here! Some of you are thinking, man. All right. So I'm going to talk a lot about making money. You okay if I talk about money?
Yes.
I'm going to talk to you a lot about money. But if you make money, don't let it go to your head like this guy.
Wow.
You don't want to have that sort of thing happen. Well, let me tell you my story quickly. So I met a man about 25 years ago, and in this one meeting with this one guy, my whole life changed. This guy asked me one question, and he made two statements that put me on a whole new course of living. It was incredible. His first question to me is, how much is the most amount of money you've ever made in a single year? Well, I thought that was a bit of a personal question. I mean, I'm Canadian. We don't like to talk about money. But I had had the best year I had ever had up to that point the year before. And so arrogantly, almost with a lot of pride, I told him that I had made $100,000 the year before, which I thought was phenomenal because nobody in my family had made that kind of money. None of my friends had made this kind of money. I was only in my mid-20s. Our country was in the middle of a recession. I told him, this was phenomenal to be in business for, I had only been in business for 2 years. So I told him, $100,000. Then he made the first of two statements. He said to me, "That is garbage." Now, you just meet somebody and they say that your income is garbage. And I thought to myself, what are you talking about? He said, it's garbage for you to make that much in a year if you can make that much in a month. I thought that guy was nuts. I was working like a dog to make $100,000 in a year. He's telling me I could do it in a month. I don't know what you would do if somebody told you that, but I didn't say to him, okay, great guru, just tell me what to do. I did what was natural to me when anybody shared an idea that seemed ridiculous, or I found out later, was outside of my paradigm, outside of my belief system, outside of what I thought I could do. I started to fight with him, and people will often reject an idea or they'll ridicule an idea. And so I started to tell him, there's no way I could earn. I don't have any money, I said to him. Because even though I was making 100, it was costing me 125 to get it. You know what I'm talking about, entrepreneur? I was living on credit cards. Even though money was coming in, I was financing everything. And so I thought you had to have money to make money. I said to him, I don't feel particularly smart. I got kicked out of school when I was 15. I told him that I grew up in poverty. My parents couldn't even afford the basics of life, like food and shelter without government assistance. They were alcoholics, and we lived in the ghetto in Ottawa, Canada, where I'm from. And so I'm telling him all these reasons to why I could never do this in a single month. I told him that our country was in the middle of a major recession. And as I'm giving him every reason why I could never do this in a single month, he made the second statement. It was worse than the first. He looked me right in the eye and he said to me, as I'm trying to defend my position, he looked at me right in the eye and said, "You are a jerk." Can you imagine? You just meet somebody, they call your income garbage, and then they call you a jerk within the first 5 minutes of meeting them. And I realized very quickly that I was either going to shut up and listen to this guy, or it was going to be a brief meeting. And he said, "Listen, I don't mean to be disrespectful, Gerry," he says, "but I'm telling you, my story is every bit as sad as yours. And I've been doing it for over 25 years, making this kind of money every month. And I'm telling you, you can do it. And you won't even entertain the idea." And he said, "Anybody who summarily dismisses an idea without grappling with it isn't thinking." And he said, "My purpose in life is to help people think." I thought to myself, what if he's right? Not about the jerk part, but what if it was possible to make just one month? How many of you here would like to make in a 1 month what you made all last year? Let me see your hands. Okay. Well, I just thought to myself, I don't believe I could do it. But I could see he believed I could do it. And I just decided that I would believe in his belief in me. And isn't it funny that when people share ideas that are outside of our paradigm, the tendency is to try and get rid of that idea? Why do people reject a good idea, even though they want that idea? Why is it so easy for people to reject an idea? Tell me.
Ego.
Pardon?
Ego.
Ego. Yeah, I'd rather be right than rich. Yes.
Fear.
Fear of?
Failure.
Fear of unknown, fear of failure. What else did somebody say? Yeah, they don't do it because they don't believe that they can do it. They've never seen it. They never maybe have achieved that kind of stuff. What else? Why do people tend to throw away a good idea?
Confidence.
Yeah, their own confidence level. They worry about what other people will think.
They are afraid to get out of comfort zone as well.
Yeah. Good answer. They tend to want to do the same thing that they've always done. And let me tell you, if you want to have a significant change, like making a month what you're making in a year, you've got to do everything differently. And that's what happened to me. I thought, I'm going to do what this guy tells me to do, and I was not going to be one of these people who just go to seminar after seminar after seminar, and their life never changes. Some of you should stop going to seminars. Can't believe I just said that, right? Stop going to seminars and start doing the seminar. I don't mean like doing it like me up here. I don't need any more competition. But if you put it into action, think of all the education you've received that you may not have done anything with yet. And so I said, I'm not going to be like those people. I'll do everything you tell me. And I did. Hey, within 12 months later, I was making every month what I used to make every year. My income shot up over $1 million in the next 12 months. And you know how they people say money won't make you happy?
No, they don't know what to
shop. They're wrong. They're wrong. And you know the people who say that all the time? Money won't make you happy? They're poor.
Yeah.
So, where was I going with that? The point is this, that when you are ready and you're ready to move into action, things can happen that will shock you. I mean, I was flabbergasted. And do you know that I've since made this much in a month?
Wow.
I routinely now make that much in a weekend.
Yoo-hoo.
I probably did it 6 times last year.
Well done.
How many of you like to have something like that happen to you?
Yeah.
Okay. If your hands didn't go up, you might have come into the wrong room here. I want to I'm going to talk to you about money and how it can change your whole life. Now keep in mind that I'm still the same guy who started broke. I had a self-esteem that didn't think a lot of myself. I didn't feel very smart. I got kicked out of school. I grew up with nothing. I just had a white hot desire. That's why I came to come and speak here. Do you know I charged $20,000 to speak like this? And I came here for nothing? Because I want to be with people like you? Because there's something about people who want to get out of the rat race that some of you I see in your eyes. And because you know what I'm talking about. I just knew there had to be more to life than what I was doing. I just knew that at some point it had to be my time. I looked at other people and I thought, what the hell do they have on me? I'm struggling like a dog to just get a paycheck to paycheck living. Do you know why they call it take-home pay, by the way? Somebody told me the other day. I said, no, why do they call it take-home pay? He said, because that's the only place people can take it and not be embarrassed. I just knew at some point it had to be my time. And I had to change everything. You know, in the past 25 years, I've put over $100 million into my bank account and that of my business partner by using some of the things I'm going to talk to you about tonight. And my publishing company, Black Card Books, is one of the fastest growing book publishing companies in the entire world. And if we stay on the same trajectory we are now, within 36 to 48 months, we'll bring in that much every year. And I'm not telling you this to brag. I hope you really get this. I'm not telling you that to brag.
A little bit.
You know, I'm telling you that because I'm still the same guy who started with nothing, who didn't feel particularly smart, did it in a terrible economy, not starting with a silver spoon in my mouth. And so that's why my message to you is, you want to get out of the rat race? If I could do it, anybody can do it. Still, I was in Amsterdam the other day, and somebody said to me, well, if you're making so much money, why are you traveling all the time? And I said to them, well, first of all, that's very rude. I said to them, I'm in the best health I've ever been. I've lost 120 pounds in the last year. How many kilo would that be? 50? 55 kilo, I've dropped them, I'm in great health. I said to them, well, what do you want me to do? Stay at home? I'm only 56 years old, I got all this energy, I love helping people. I said, you want me to stay home? Listen, if I stay home and I retire, the people wondered if I could retire right now, I don't need to work another day in my life. But what I asked them is, what kind of life would that be? You know, if I retired, this would be me and my wife on Sunday afternoons. This is how I would entertain myself if I was retired. We're just out on our Sunday afternoon drive. Slides like it are people who are just like you. They came to this one lecture that I have, and they came to the boot camp that I'm going to talk to you about at the end, and they're ordinary people. They're not writer types. I don't attract writer types typically because my ideas are much more entrepreneurial and money oriented. So you can do this. So some of you have been thinking, how many of you said you thought about writing a book in the past? Let me see your hands. How many keep your hands up if you've been thinking about it for more than a year? Keep your hands up. More than a year you've been thinking about it? More than 5 years? More than 10 years? Your hand's not stuck, is it? How long have you been thinking about it?
A long time.
You're going to be very depressed by the end of tonight. What stops people? Because most people say they want to write a book, and they wait 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, sometimes longer. What stops them? Tell me. Time. And yet they'll spend 42 hours a week on Facebook. Get the hell off Facebook. Anyway, we'll talk about that later. Stop watching television. Anyway, so time stops people. What else stops people?
Don't know where to stop. Now,
what am I going to write about? Who would want to read anything that I'm going to write? Yeah, what else?
Knowledge.
Pardon?
The effort it's going to take.
It's going to take effort to do it, yeah.
Knowledge.
Yeah, just knowledge. What do I have what it takes? What else holds people back? Pardon? Just laziness. You know, it's so easy. One of the problems people have today, and it's one of the worst things that could happen to you, is you have a comfortable life. If you got a paycheck that's handling all the bills, and everybody look at her, she's working in this company. Wow, set for life. There's no impetus for a lot of us to, if you're in that situation. Well, what I want to do tonight is hopefully make you laugh a little bit, but get you to think outside of the box. And you got to be willing to entertain new ideas. My thing is everybody's got an obstacle. And I want the black cat to represent whatever stopped you, those of you who've thought about writing a book. And those of you who have never thought about writing a book, just stay with me for a second. Keep an open mind. Don't reject it like I was going to reject my mentor just because it doesn't fit in your belief system right now. Okay? I've got thousands and tens of thousands of people who've been to our boot camps, who've published books, and I'm telling you, they're shocked how easy it is, but they never would have got there if they rejected the idea. I think to myself, my goodness, what would have happened if, when my mentor told me I could make that much in a month, what would have happened if I'd have rejected that idea? I shudder to think now what I would have done. So, the black cat represents your obstacle, okay? It's the thing that stops you so far. After you come to my boot camp, I train you, that big obstacle, boom, it'll just instantly go away. So don't worry about why you can't write a book. Just let me show you how you can go about doing it. The problem in my estimation, this is a book entitled Everything Men Know About Women. All the pages are blank. Is that most people feel that they have to write a big, huge book. Come later and have a look at some of these books. I've got just tons of them here. We have about 500 or 600, because my book publishing company is publishing about 500 or 600 books right now. Look at these, they're not huge. And so you've got to get rid of the picture you have in your head of what the kind of book you have to publish. Here's the problem. Most people feel that the book that they're going to write has to be a world-changing book. A book that's earth-shattering, industry-revolutionizing. A book that's personality-altering. A history-making book. An incomprehensibly complicated work of art. A book that's totally original, with never-before-heard-of content. A book that's massively sized, masterfully written in perfect English, a one-of-a-kind book without one single spelling mistake. See, most people feel that they're not smart enough to write a book. They're terrible spellers. I'm a terrible speller. Man, none of that's important. I'm suggesting an 80 to 100 page book for most of you is all you got to write. You get 10 simple little chapters with 8 to 10 pages each. It's a breeze. It doesn't have to be a new content. It doesn't have to be an exhaustive book on everything known to man about this particular topic. And if you do that, then everything will change. You'll see things in a new way. You'll become much more creative. You'll feel better about yourself. Because instead of just thinking about writing it, you've actually done it. And then you'll see the power of this thing to bring money to you, to give you confidence to step out, to create multiple sources of income, to catapult your sales, to generate leads, all of these things. And it allows you to be much more creative. Like this, I don't know if you've seen this ad, a very creative ad. Just watch this. I want to give you 8 steps that you should think about if you're going to do it this way. The thing is, that wasn't anything profound. Why are they talking? I want you to know that even though you may not think you can do it, you've got to give yourself permission. And when you see the kind of money that this can bring to you, you'll get excited about doing it. Okay, step number one. This is a book we did by a plastic surgeon. Look at all the publicity he's received because he wrote a book called The Beverly Hills Shape. Now, his book is about plastic surgery, and so there's a lot of before and after pictures of breast augmentation. So that helps with publicity. Of course, make sure that if you do that, your book has something to do with that topic. But just look at this. So the first step that I recommend is that you think first about what the primary objective is for your book. Not what the book is going to be about, but what do you want the book to do for you? Let me illustrate it this way. So a book can do all kinds of things, right? But you want to ask yourself, what's the main reason you want to write this book? Is it to get leads? Is it to create a source of income that allows you to supplement your current income, do that for 6 months, and then maybe step away from what you're doing after you've proven that this method will work? I believe that there's nothing that is more lucrative in terms of an investment vehicle than a book is. You know, if you think of how much money you could make, not from selling the book, but using the book to sell what you're selling now, it'll shock you about how much money there is around this book. So I illustrate this idea by asking the question, what do you want a book to do for you? So one time this guy comes to my seminar, and because I own a book publishing company, he wants to show me his manuscript. Well, I don't care about manuscripts. Not right now anyway. And so I said, what's the book about? He says, it's a book of poems. And I guess I rolled my eyes like that, and he could see that I'm not really a poem kind of guy. And he said, no, listen! And he puts his finger right in my face like this. I said, dude, relax. I said, what is it? He said, these poems are different. Well, I thought to myself, okay, what do you mean? He said, these poems are designed to teach men how to connect more intimately with their boys, their sons. Well, I got 3 boys. I love the concept. He reads me the poems. Sure enough, I start getting teary-eyed at the back. It was a book designed to teach men how to be connected more with their children. Is that a good book idea?
Yeah.
Right. So then my first question to him is, what do you want the book to do for you? He says, well, I want the book to get me publicity. Because I do a seminar, and if I get publicity, and I can talk about my seminar, men will come to my seminar, and he says, Gerry, if they come to my seminar, I'm going to change their life. And I'll change the life of their boys. Is that a good objective?
Yes.
But that objective will never be reached with this objective, or with this book. You're never going to hear somebody on the BBC or on the radio say, when we come back from the break, we got a guy who's going to talk about poetry. You don't get publicity with a book of poems. I said, if you want to think about this first, see, don't start with the content. Ask yourself what you want the book to do for you. If you really want to get publicity, don't write a book entitled a book of poetry. Write a book entitled How to Make Sure Your Boys Don't End Up Like Michael Jackson. Would that get publicity?
Yes.
Yeah. And so when we tell people right at the start, don't worry about what your content is. First ask yourself, what do you want the book to do for you? If you want to become a speaker, write a book. You'll get invited to speak. You know, in the UK, even brand new speakers at conventions, associations, company meetings, seminars, brand new speakers who are authors can make between 2,500 and 5,000 per speech. And if you do seminars, you know, just think about it. If you have a coaching business, do we have any coaches in here? Life coaches, business coaches? No. If you set up another type of training program, you can make 10 times that. And so from a starting point of view, ask yourself, what's the main reason you want to use this book? The next thing is you got to write the right content. And so most of you think it's got to be this phenomenal book, exhaustive book, with every thought known to mankind about that particular topic. And I'm saying no. You know, if you were to take me and put me in the middle of the UK with no money and told me that I had to go into a profession that I'd never done anything with, the first thing I'd do is I'd write a book about that subject. If you said to me I had to be a car salesperson, the very first thing I'd do is I would write a book called 8 or 9 Questions to Ask Before You Buy a New Car. Even though I don't know anything about cars, you don't need to be an expert before you write a book on a subject. I would write a book called 9 Questions to Ask Before You Buy a New Car. I would phone 9 of the top car salespeople in the world. I would phone them and I would say, hey, Chris, I understand you're one of the best people in the world. I'm the author of an upcoming book called 9 Questions to Ask Before You Buy a New Car. Would you mind if I interview you for 20 minutes and give me your tips? I wouldn't do it for people in my city. I would go around the world. And can you imagine if somebody phoned you and said that they wanted to interview you for a book? Yeah, I'll give you 20 minutes. So I would do that, and I would offer the book for free in a newspaper. Let me ask you here, and watch this. How many people here, if you saw an ad today in the newspaper today, and it offered a free book entitled 9 Questions to Ask Before You Buy a New Car, how many of you would call to get that free book? Let me see your hands. Look at that. Look around. Keep your hands up so everybody can see. Almost everybody. Now, what have I just done? Instead of chasing customers, you use a book to make customers come to you. And even though I wouldn't necessarily know anything about the subject. And so what this guy did, he was an accountant. Do we have any accountants here tonight? Only one. And the nice ones come to seminars. All the rest don't do anything at night. Well, this guy's an accountant, and he wanted to have a creative outlet. He wanted to become a humorous speaker. But he said, what can I write about? I said, I gave him some ideas. You know what he did? The entire book is called Laugh Life. The entire book is nothing but jokes that circulate around the internet. And all he does is he took all those jokes, put it in a book. He didn't even write it. He just copied down the funniest jokes, put them in a book. He now sells his services for $1,500 to be an after-dinner speaker. He stands behind the rostrum. He reads the jokes. That's all he does. He's making more money part-time than he is full-time as an accountant. And he's going to do this enough times until he becomes clear that this is going to work. And he's going to let go of the accountancy. Because that's where his passion lies. Listen, you should do what you want to do. This is not a practice run, this life. This is it. So you got to find something that motivates you and follow that dream. But it doesn't have to be complicated. He did it with just jokes. Can I share one of his jokes, my favorite joke from this book? Yeah. See, I'm enthusiastically asking you the question. Can I share one of the best jokes from his book?
Yes!
So, little Johnny's outside out in the park. He sees a package of Viagra pills. He goes and talks to his father and says, Dad, I've got these pills. I'll sell them to you for $100. Father says, I'm in pretty good health, son. I don't need those. Go and ask Grandpa. So he goes across the street and he says to Gramps, I'll sell you these pills for $100. He says, well, do you think that they'll work? And He says, I don't know, but they look exactly like the ones that are advertised on TV. And so Grandpa says, tell you what, I'll try them tonight, and if they work tomorrow morning, I'll give you $100. Johnny says, that's great. Comes back the next morning. Grandpa gives him $500. He said, Gramps, I thought we agreed on 100. He said, keep it. The rest is from Grandma. Wow. So, just to illustrate this whole point about you don't have to be an expert, this young man, David Chua, comes to my seminar, and he's in network marketing. And he wanted to do a book on network marketing. I said, if you're in network marketing, don't write a book on network marketing. My goodness. Write what the people in network marketing want, which is money, wealth. He says to me, how could I possibly write a book on wealth? I said, you don't have to be an expert in a topic to write a book about it. And he looked at me like I was like a deer on the highway, you know, was like, what? You see, you don't have to know anything about wealth building to write a book on wealth building. Think about everything that I'm talking about here, because there's lots of types of books, isn't there? One is, this is my story. Another one is, this is my advice. Another one is, this is what wealthy people say you need to do. That's exactly what Napoleon Hill did with Think and Grow Rich. He was broke, he was a reporter when he wrote that book. And so I told David, David's 20 years old, go and interview wealthy people. Find out what their advice is, and then write that as the content. You know, if you take interviews from several different people, you record it, you put it through your experience, your blender, it's just like an opportunity for you to say, here's what I've researched, and here's what I think is the best advice out there. And again, you got to keep in mind, the way I'm talking about, we're not looking to get Rich Dad, Poor Dad off the bestseller list. We're talking about using a book to fill a seminar, to create additional sources of income, to allow you to build your current business. It's not about selling books. There's very little money doing that. So you get the right content and serve and view yourself as a reporter. That's all you gotta do. Then the first thing you gotta do is you gotta design an awesome cover. You know, so much of marketing in this day and age is optics, how you look to other people. So the cover is very crucial. There's just a few covers of books we've recently published. You know, when you're an estate agent like this guy is, and you tell people that you've written a book on this subject and you can show them this book cover, even a JPEG like this guy, I believe he's an insurance agent in Singapore. He's gotten all kinds of business for his insurance agency before the book even came out. So the cover design is critical. So one guy comes up with this cover. He had published the book before he came to the seminar. I said to him, has this helped you much? He said, no, it hasn't helped me much. And so I turned it from that to that. You see the difference, how the perception is completely different. The other thing is, if you can, make sure the cover, if you can use humor or something different or shocking, and no, that's not me. I know some of you are wondering. There's only so much I'll do for our authors. But so the cover is critical. Look at this cover. I mean, it just, whenever you could use the word sex in a cover, by the way, it'll significantly increase its effectiveness as a marketing tool. Now make sure you're writing about the topic, don't just throw the word in there. Just look how powerful that cover is. And so humor, I find, is also a very good thing. But in order for you to think, you got to think outside of the box when it comes to covers. I don't know if you've seen this ad from Old Spice. Watch this.
Hello, ladies. Look at your man. Now back to me. Now back at your man. Now back to me. Sadly, he isn't me. But if he stopped using lady-scented body wash and switched to Old Spice, he could smell like he's me. Look down. Back up. Where are you? You're on a boat with a man your man could smell it. What's in your head? Back at me. I am. It's an oyster with two tickets to that thing you love. Look again. The tickets are now diamond. Anything is possible when your man smells like Old Spice and not a lady. I'm on a horse.
So you got to think outside of the box when it comes, as they did for advertising Old Spice. But the idea here is you got to be willing to entertain new ideas. The next step is step number four, which is I suggest that you give away your book in the form of a downloadable version of the book. People today love to get things for free. And so when you offer a book, it has a $20 to $30 pound perception. And I think what you do is you get a single web page, a squeeze page, a landing page, opt-in page, whatever you want. You put a short little video on it. The video just offers the free book, and you start sending people there. If people go to your website, watch your video, and give you their name and email address, that's a hot prospect. Even though your book may not come out for 6 to 9 to 12 months later, you've got the lead right now, and you start nurturing that relationship. They'll see you much different than anybody else, and all of a sudden, you'll realize that the money is in the database. And a book allows you to take people who are predisposed to buy what you sell and make them come directly to you. Let me skip this quickly. Step number five is to use a book to build sales. Listen, we live in a day and age where people are very skeptical about any of us who sell anything. People are overwhelmed with pressure, with marketing messages, and so they don't trust those of us who sell. And so the way to mitigate against all that skepticism and distrust is to see, for them to see you on a book cover. Because we tend to see people who are authors as authority figures, even though you may be brand new in an industry. It's got a phenomenal tool, a power as a tool. You use a book to differentiate yourself from everybody else. These are estate agents from America. And they're all the same. Many people in your industry are all doing the same thing. I say use a book as a marketing tool. You use this as a name call, as a calling card, and watch how people see you and perceive you significantly differently. A book is a phenomenal tool when it comes to sales in opening up new doors. You know, this lady, Mary Beth Haynes, interviewed 82 prospects for her business by asking them if she could interview them for her book. She got in there, got a relationship, she got great content for her book, but then more importantly, she opened the door that were previously closed. Some of you have been trying to get into some companies for years, just phone the MD of that company and ask if you could interview them for your upcoming book and watch how fast you're gonna get in there. That's the power of this thing. You send your book to famous people. This is Angela Jackson from here in London. She is a relationship coach. She had been abused as a child and became a trauma coach to try and help people overcome this. I published her book and she said to me, will you come to my book launch party? Well, I said to her kiddingly, I'll come if Her Majesty the Queen comes. She must have thought I was serious. She sends a copy of her book and an invitation for the Queen of England to come to her book launch party. 2 weeks later, she gets a letter back from Buckingham Palace. Declining, of course, but the last sentence of the letter says, the Queen was interested to read the reasons behind the writing of your book and thought it kind of you to send her a copy as a gift. Now, can you imagine? Royalty's not allowed to endorse a particular product, but, and this is pretty close, isn't it? Yeah. She's been featured all over the newspaper and magazines and TV and radio in London because of that letter. So you have no idea if you give this book to certain people. Now, don't give it to the Queen. She's on to me, and you know, she's not sending letters anymore. But you get the idea. You know, in terms of sales, you give that book to somebody, as I mentioned earlier, before you make a sales call, you'll be perceived completely differently. The next step is to use a book to get publicity globally, and there's nothing like a book to get you more publicity. I have been, how many of you have seen the movie The Secret? Yeah. So Bob, how many of you know who Bob Proctor is? Yeah. So Bob is a former business partner of mine. I've been able to get him all kinds, and him and other big time speakers. There's a bunch of speakers, I can't tell you who they are, but you know them. Some of them walk on fire, or some of them are really big, and I can't tell you who those people are. But I work with a lot of these people. Non-disclosure things, I can't tell you who they are. How many of you know who Harv Eker is? I can't tell you that, who I've worked with, but some of them think a lot. But anyway, yeah. See, a book is the thing that gets you publicity, even if you're brand new. You do not have to be Tony Robbins, Robert Kiyosaki, Richard Branson to get publicity. You saw what happened to Angela Jackson. She's a coach. She's a therapist here in London. Get all kinds of publicity because she wrote a book. So it's great for that purposes. Remember I told you about David Chua? Before his book even came out, he's had all kinds of articles written about him, and the guy's 20 years old. The key to open doors for publicity, and when you can have, is a book. And if you can have this kind of marketing material on your website, people will see you differently. They'll come to your events. They'll buy what it is you're selling much differently than if you're just, you know, flogging what it is your product is. See, in this case, you don't talk about your business anymore. Talk about your book. People don't trust you these days. But when they see a book, so that's what you promote. You promote your book. Look at this lady. She's an insurance agent. Look at how much publicity she got within the first year of getting her book. A small 80-page book called Protect Yourself. Never done it before. This lady was a school teacher for 30 years. She retired. Time magazine was doing a story on women in transition. She got into Time magazine. I could just go on forever. Remember Mary Beth Haynes did a book on pet loss? There's a full-page article written about her in a Toronto newspaper. Look at the size of that picture. This is Alexander Wu. He's a mortgage broker. Look at him. He's got a full-page ad written about him. He's been featured in newspapers and magazines. He brags about the fact that his picture, there he is there, his picture is 4 times the size of this picture, and that's the president or the prime minister of Malaysia, where he lives. He's quite proud of himself. And all he is a mortgage broker with a powerful tool, the book. And he's been featured everywhere. So give somebody a high five and say, you can do it. Come on. Now, the real interesting thing is that I can show you how to get other people to pay for all the costs. This is Mary Beth Haynes.
My name is Mary.
Listen to her for a second.
And you know, becoming an author has completely changed my life. I've gotten free publicity, and the best part is that I've been able to raise enough money to pay for the whole thing.
So, she had never sold anything. She was not a salesperson. But if I could show you how to raise 10, 20, 30, 40, 50,000 pounds before you write one word, how many of you want to know how to do that? Good. That's exactly what you can do, and it's an easy thing to do if you've got a book and the right optics around the book. Step number 7 is how to get other people to pay for all the costs. See, it costs money to do all of this, and you can get that money from other people. One of the ways you do it is you sell advertisements in the back of the book. Now, I'm not talking about 100, I'm talking about 10, 7, 5. And what you do is you find people who don't compete with you but also want to get in front of your reader. If you're a mortgage broker, you're going to get an estate agent, you get an inspection company, you get a moving company, and you sell them a page of advertising. This lady raised $45,000 Australian dollars by selling 7 or 8 ads in the back of her book. You see, there are people who are currently spending money right now trying to get and influence your readers. They'll pay for everything because they have an opportunity, for instance, to be the only estate agent in the back of your book. And so we've had people all over the world sell advertisements, a few advertisements in the back of their book, and it funds the entire project, and in some cases puts a profit in their bank account. And this before they write one word. Now you've got to have the book cover done, you've got to have the title done, the chapter outline, and you need what we call an advertising kit. It's like a media kit that helps you sell those advertisements. But it's possible for people to raise everything that they need before they write one word. Another thing that she did is you could sell a bonus chapter in the back of the book. She's doing a book for seniors on how to protect themselves. She's a financial advisor. She goes to a law firm, sells them a bonus chapter on the back of the book, and all of a sudden they pay her $7,500 to include one chapter in the back of the book as a bonus. See, there's lots of different methods. I cover 6 of them in my boot camp. This is just too quickly ways for people to raise funds before they write the book. You like that idea?
Yeah.
Good. The last step, and I'll be done with this, is you got to decide. If you're going to do it, whether it's this or anything else, if you're going to escape the rat race, at some point, you've just got to say, I'm doing it. And you know, one of the problems that I have found with people is they say, when I figure out exactly how to do it, then I'm going to take a chance, then I'm going to step out. It's the exact opposite I found. You know, when you make a decision, hey, by this time, my book will be out, or I'm going to be out of the rat race by December 31st. The minute you put your line in the sand and you make a decision, it's amazing what kind of stuff gets attracted to you to help you make that decision a reality. But unless you're willing to make that decision, it'll just be year after year after year. You see, someone said, I'll believe it when I see it. It's the other way around. Once you believe it, you'll see it. So when it comes to this book, you got to decide. And I found out by reading Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich, that wealthy people make decisions quickly and rarely change their mind. And broke people take forever to make their mind up. And then once they do make their mind up, they're constantly switching it. So the first thing you got to do is, and I found this one quote for you guys, because it's not normally in my talk, but far better it is to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though checkered by failure, than to rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy nor suffer much because they live in the gray twilight that knows neither victory or defeat. See, that's why I come here tonight, because you guys relate to this. You understand what it's like. So, I'm done. Have you gotten anything, a couple of good ideas? How many of you enjoyed tonight's talk? You learned something? Good. I'm going to talk to you about my seminar quickly, and then we'll be done. Because the next speaker is so much better than me. Seriously, he's really good. He's got a lot of good information, so I'm going to be brief. If any of you want to download these slides, you can go to downloadmyslides.com. This talk is called 8 Steps. You can download the PowerPoint if you want to review for later. Before I do that, it's always good to get people thinking and laughing. I don't know if you've seen this or not. One of my favorite videos. Okay, let me go through quickly. If you'd like to pull out the sheet, I'm gonna direct your attention to a few things. So I'm doing the seminar. I'm doing two of them in the next. Actually, it's not February 6th. Yeah, it is February 6th. What? We're March. We're March already. So that's March 6th. Is it March 6th, Chuck? This weekend, anyway, at the Metropole Locale. And then I'm doing it again in April. So I'll go through quickly. It's a Friday night, all day Saturday, and all day Sunday. 5 modules. The first module is to plan it. So on Friday night, we show you how to get the right book. If you're not sure what to write about, and many people come to our class, they never, ever thought about writing a book. There's a bunch of people who thought about writing a book, and maybe they got more than one book in them. There is a right book and a wrong book if you want to get the fastest path to the biggest cash. So by Friday night, the end of Friday night, you'll know exactly which book's going to bring you the most amount of money. And it's all focused on the fastest path to the biggest cash. So if you're looking to become a Pulitzer Prize winner, this is not a seminar for you. If you want to write a book on a children's book or a poetry book, this is not the seminar for you. But if you want to get out of the rat race, this is exactly where you ought to go. That's on Friday night. Saturday morning is a session called Write It. If you've ever thought of challenged, if you've had a challenge writing a book, that'll be absolutely finished by Saturday at noon. I have a system on how I teach people how to write a book in 40 hours. Now, some of you have been thinking about writing a book for 40 years. You'll be able to write it in 40 hours using this system. Am I right?
Correct.
It's a phenomenal system. You'll never, ever have a problem writing if you use this system. Then on Saturday afternoon, we have a session called Fund It, how you can make big money before you physically get the book, before you publish the book. I teach 6 methods, and I go into obviously a lot more detail than I've had time to do it tonight. 6 methods, step by step by step, what you've got to do to start raising money to pay for this and generating income before you write one more. And if you think, just to show you, to illustrate this is Ranford Neo. He joins the seminar. He sends me an email a couple of days after the seminar, a couple of weeks, I guess, after the seminar. Listen to what this kid did. I think he's 22. He's from Singapore. He's in military service. They have compulsory military service.
Hi, Gerry. That's all. Thank you for what you have taught me during the boot camp in March this year. To give you an update on my progress, to date, I've raised more than $15,000 in terms of sponsorships and pre-sold more than 600 books, not 700. My mistake. But you know what the best part is? I've not even started working on my book yet. So what you really thought, me, is really amazing. And I'm still recovering from the state of shock, you know, that I'm able to raise such an amount. I'm only at 22 years old, still in national service. But like what you always say, when you collect the money, you gotta finish the book lah. So I'm working hard on it now. So I feel so excited for all the participants that will be attending your book camp next week. They are definitely in for a treat. So hope to see you soon, Gerry.
So, did you catch what he said, right? If you, I'm going to show you how to get money before you write one word. And do you know it's a law in the UK that if you take money, you have to deliver the product. Do you know something? If you do collect money, you will finish the product. I'm going to tell you a story. I'll show you on the weekend a story of a lady who made $5,100 in one night before she had written one word. I'll show you exactly how she does it. It's one of the six methods we cover on the boot camp. And then, of course, on Saturday afternoon, we have Publish It, which is all the technical issues about how do you get it printed, what's the ISBN number, what copyright issues, all those things. And then we even show you how to get celebrity endorsements. All of these people, celebrities endorsed my books when I was 25 years old. I had no experience. I had never published anything. And I'm going to show you the exact method I use to get celebrity endorsements, and our people get celebrity endorsements. Even though they're just average, ordinary people. There's a method to it, and I'll show you exactly how to do that. Now, all day Sunday, we'll go from about 9 till about 5 or 6 on Sunday, 5, we show you how to move the book. You see, getting the book is the easy part. Getting rid of that thing is going to be the challenge. And so we devote a whole day to that. It's mostly marketing, yet most people have this figures inversed. They think it's all about content, and they leave the marketing to somebody else. That doesn't happen.